Hi, I'm Rick Emerson. Welcome back to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. We're here with Courtney Hommeister, who is the head writer and host for LiveWire Radio. And LiveWire is known for having what we might call an eclectic panoply of guests.
And nice phrase.
Well, it's what I do.
Yeah, those are good occasionally, words.
Occasionally, now and again, mm-hmm. sporadically. You have a lot of people on the docket, as they say, coming up. And I made a few notes here. Angus MacLean,
yes.
Who's worked on numerous Pixar films, mm-hmm. I think. As well as Sean Levy, who's mm-hmm. a writer and works for the Oregonian as well, and Captain Bog and Salty, who are a pirate rock folk
yes.
band thing.
Yes, they are. They're a pirate band.
Please do explain.
I think that we've billed them as the pirate band that your mother warned you about, but in actuality, they are. They have a huge kids following, and Lauren Hoskins, who is he would be Captain Bog. He's actually described. I watched a video of them online one time, and I think they were at the Aladdin, and they had this giant mosh pit of children losing their minds watching this band. They were all in the front of the theater, and Lauren refers to it as Fisher Price, my first mosh pit.
So. Am I right in saying that Andy Lindberg, I think his name is, who was in Captain Bog and Salty, was also the character of Hogan in Stand By Me? He is the man of larger carriage who eats the blueberry pies in the contest?
I've heard this, but I've not met him, and so I can't confirm or deny that information.
Okay,
it could just be.
This was all a passive way to get you to say that, so I could say, I have talked to him, and it's totally true.
Oh,
he was also a camp counselor here in Oregon for quite some time, and the rumor sort of filtered out that, hey, you know, that guy in Captain Bog and Salty, he was also Andy Lindberg, and he was also camp counselor, and he was also the guy in Stand By Me, eats the blueberry pies, and we didn't think it was true on our radio show, and we tracked him down, and it is true. Which leads me to my next question, which is
Have I ever projectile vomited after eating a pie?
Well, that's a given. I mean,
of course, who hasn't?
Why must you insult me, miss? I won't.
Sorry.
Have it.
Go ahead.
Moving forward. So you have Andy Lindberg on one hand, you have Angus MacLean, who's worked for Pixar, on the other
yeah.
hand, you have Sean Levy, who is, again, writes for the Oregonian, any number of books. How do you explain the draw for this disparate group of people? What do you think they all see in LiveWire that attracts them?
Well, I think that for anybody, where I would hope that we're this great stage, literal stage, for them to talk about what it is that they do, to talk about what they're passionate about, or to perform what they're passionate about. And what's great is that I feel like our audiences are just we have really enthusiastic audiences, and they're just open to just about anything that's going to happen. So I think that anyone who's seen the show recognizes that as a possibility.
On the note of anything that can happen, one of the hallmarks of live radio is the ever-looming threat of disaster. And
right.
sometimes that threat does more than loom. It asserts itself kind of aggressively.
Yeah.
Have you had moments of crises, technical or otherwise?
We have. We definitely have. The most memorable for me was when we were at the Hollywood. The Hollywood Theater has a couple of upstairs theaters that are smaller, and we were very excited. We moved down to the big theater downstairs, and we were this was when Rob Sample was hosting, and at the beginning of every LiveWire show there's what we call a cold open, like they do on Saturday Night Live, and at the end of it someone in the sketch says it's and the audience screams LiveWire. Somebody whips up a sign and everyone does what they're told, and like a relationship. In any case, so this happens, and it's the bigger theater, it's the bigger audience, the biggest audience we've had. Somebody whips up the sign, the audience screams LiveWire, and all the lights went out. We lost all power at that exact moment that the audience said that.
Did they think it was part of the evening's performance?
I would imagine that they did, but of
How
course
dramatic.
When the lights came up and there was this giant buzzing noise, they realized, oh, this is an actual problem.
Oh, something has gone terribly wrong.
Exactly.
And so what happens in those moments? You're there and it's being taped for playback later, but it's still
yeah.
more or less live. It is live to tape, and so you want to keep, the show must go on and all that. So at that moment, does somebody just go out and just sort of work the crowd?
At that point, no. That's definitely something that we've learned, and I think we're unbelievably lucky in that we've had some of the best improvisers in Portland in our cast. Tyler Hughes, Maine Pelletier, who has since moved away, John Paul McClellan, They're people who have been in Brainwaves, who have done Super Project Lab, and so they're able to actually just play when things go wrong. I'm less of an improviser, so I generally look to them. I just sort of am a deer in the headlights, oh crap kind of person.
You should put that on your resume.
Yeah,
writer and oh crap kind of person.
I think everyone looks for someone who can't do anything when a problem arises. I think that's, you know, that's what everybody looks for.
On that note, we will take a brief moment. When we return, we'll talk about the creative process and we'll talk about some of the most memorable moments from Livewire Radio and its history in Portland. You're watching Outlook Portland right here on Northwest 32 TV. Stay there.